Hello, my dear students. We are discussing a level of second paper, and under that we are discussing the Payment of Wages Act 1932, and this is given under unit second of this paper. And today we'll talk about the fines and certain other deductions from the wages of the employed person. This is video lecture number 15. When we talk about the fines under Section 8 of the Payment of Wages Act 1936, Section 8, subsection 1, no fine shall be imposed on any employed person save in respect of such acts and omissions on his part as the employer, with the previous approval of the appropriate government or of the prescribed authority, may be specified by notice under subsection 2. So section 8 of the Payment of Wages Act talks about the fines and it states that no fine shall be imposed on any employed person in respect of such acts and omissions on his part as the employer and with the previous approval of the appropriate government or of the prescribed authority approval. And under subsection 2 of this section, a notice specifying such acts and omissions shall be exhibited in the prescribed manner on the premises in which the employment is carried on. So there has to be a notice which will specify the acts, the omissions, and that shall be exhibited in the prescribed manner on the premises in the employment, which is, you know, carried on, or in the case of person employed upon railway, or means otherwise than in factory, then at the prescribed place or places that notice should be exhibited. Under section 8, subsection 3 states that the no fine shall be imposed on any employed person until he has been given an opportunity of showing cause against the fine or otherwise than in accordance with the procedure as may be prescribed for the imposition of fine. This is subsection 3 of section 8. And subsection 4 of this section 8 regarding fines talks about the total amount of fine which may be imposed in any one wage period on any employed person shall not exceed an amount equal to 3% of the wages payable to him in respect of that wage period. This is subsection 4, that total amount of fine which may be imposed in any one wage period of any employed person shall not exceed an amount equal to 3% of the wages payable to him in respect of that wage period, not more than that. And then section 8, subsection 5, that no fine shall be imposed on any employed person who is under the age of 15 years. So no fine as per section 8 subsection 5 shall be imposed on an employed person under the age of 15 years. And subsection 6 of this section 8 states that no fine imposed on any employed person shall be recovered from him by installments. So no recovery of fine by installments or after the expiry of 90 days from the day on which this fine was imposed. So this is again very important regarding fines. And subsection 7 of section 8 talks about that every fine shall be deemed to have been imposed on that day of the act or omission in respect of which it was imposed. So when the fine was imposed, a fine shall be deemed to have been imposed on that day only, wherever it was imposed. And then subsection 8 of section 8 states that all fines and restrictions thereof shall be recorded in our register. So whatever fines are being imposed, all fines and all realizations, for those fines thereof shall be recorded in a register to be kept by the person responsible for the payment of wages under section 3 in such form as may be prescribed, and all such realization shall be applied only to such purposes beneficial to the persons employed in the factory or establishments as are approved by the prescribed authority. So these are certain important subsections given under section 8. And when the persons employed upon or in any railway factory or means industrial or any other establishment or part only of a staff employed under the same management, all such realizations may be credited to a common fund maintained for the staff as a whole, and provided that the fund shall be applied only to such purposes as are approved by the prescribed authority. So, and there are certain other deductions may be done from the wages for absence from duty under section 9, and deductions may be made under clause B of subsection 2 of section 7 that we have referred in our previous lectures, previous deliberations. The deductions from the wages of an employed person, right, and deductions for absence from duty, we have seen under section 7 subsection 2 and clause B. Only on account of the absence of an employed person from the place or places where by the terms of his employment or her employment he is required to work, such absence being for the whole or any part of the period during which he is so required to work. So those deductions may be done from the wages of the worker employed. And the amount of such deduction shall be, subsection 2 of section 9 state that amount of such deduction shall be in no case bear to the wages payable to the employed person in respect of the wage period for which the deduction is made a larger portion than the period for which he was absent bears to the total period. And within such wage period during which by the terms of the employment he was required to work, right? And appropriate means provided that subject to any rules made in this behalf by the appropriate government, if 10 or more employed persons acting in concern absent themselves without due notice, without giving the notice which is required under the terms of their contracts of employment, and without reasonable cause it's happening, then such deductions from any such person may include such amount not exceeding his wage for 8 days as may be, any such terms to be due to the employer in lieu of due notice. And for the purpose of this section, an employed person shall be deemed to be absent from the place where he is required to work if, although present in such place, but he refuses in pursuance of a stay, and he stay in a strike or for any other cause which is not reasonable in the circumstances to carry out his work. And there are certain other deductions for damages or loss under section 10. And section 10 subsection 1 states that a deduction under clause C or clause O of subsection 2 of section 7 shall not exceed the amount of damage or loss caused to the employer by the neglect or default of the employed person. So means deduction under clause C or clause O of section 2 of subsection 7. So deductions under subsection 2 and clause C, deductions for damage to or loss of goods expressly entrusted to the employed person for custody, right? And in clause O, as we were referring, we have seen that deductions for recovery of losses sustained by a railway administration on account of any rebate or refunds incorrectly granted by the employed person. So all those maybe deductions can be done. And in section 10, first A, deductions shall not be made under clause C and clause M, clause N, clause O of subsection 2 of section 7 until the employed person has given an opportunity to showing cause against the deduction. So an opportunity should be given. And under section 10 subsection 2, for when we talk about the deductions for damage or loss, all such deductions and all realization thereof shall be recorded in a register to be kept by the person responsible for the payment of wages under section 3 in such form as may be prescribed. And I mean, apart from these deductions, you know, there are certain deductions for the services rendered under section 11 and deductions under clause D, clause E of subsection 2 of section 7. And clause D talks about the deductions for house accommodation supplied by the employer or by the government or any housing board set up under any law. And when we talk about the clause E of this subsection 2 of section 7, deductions for such amenities and services supplied by the employer as the state government or any officer specified. So those deductions can be made. Deductions for the recovery of the advances can also be made under section 12. Deductions for recovery of loans under section 12 can also be done. And deductions from the wages can also be done for payment to cooperative societies and insurance scheme under section 13. And see, maintenance of registered and records is also required under section 13A, and every employer shall maintain such registered, such records giving such particulars of the persons employed by him, or means any work performed by them, the amount of wage paid to them, deductions made from their wages, if any receipt is given them, then that record may also be maintained over there, right? This is section 13A, subsection 1. And subsection 2 of this section 13A talks about that every register and record required to be maintained under this section shall, for the purpose of this act, be preserved for a period of 3 years after the date of the last entry made there, right? So this is all about the important deductions from the wages, about the fines. So my dear students, I believe this deliberation, these PPTs will help you. Thank you so much, and you just go through these PPTs and stay safe and healthy. Thank you so much. Take care.